Why do so many Americans support Donald Trump? He is refusing to budge on his controversial comments to bar Muslims from the United States. So what's driving the potential Republican president to the forefront of US politics despite a chorus of criticism from around the world? This is Inside Story. Hello, welcome to the program. I'm Jane Dutton. The White House says he's disqualified himself from becoming president, and the Pentagon says he's called to ban Muslims from the U.S. endangers security. But Donald Trump is standing by his controversial comments, and he's got the support of various conservative commentators and at least part of the U.S. public. So how has Trump been able to set the tone in the Republican presidential race? And why do his comments resonate with so many Americans? Before we bring in our guests, Kimberly Helkett helps set up our discussion from Washington, D.C.
I am officially running.
From the moment he announced his candidacy, Donald Trump has been testing the patience of fellow Republicans with his rhetoric. Now, many say, though, he's gone too far.
This is not conservatism. What was proposed yesterday is not what this party stands for, and more importantly, it's not what this country stands for.
Ryan says there are many Muslim members of the U.S. Congress and armed forces who, as Americans, are assisting the U.S. in its fight against extremism. Still, Trump standing by his call to close U.S. borders to those who practice the Islamic faith until threats can be contained.
A total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States until our country's representatives can figure out what the hell is going on.
Trump's comments were met with applause on Monday and may appeal to a subset of conservative voters who are looking for an easy solution to a complex security problem. But not all conservatives support the proposals. Many Republicans are also evangelical Christians who believe religious freedom is a part of the U.S. Constitution that must be protected. One Southern Baptist leader criticized Trump, saying anyone who cares an iota about religious liberty should denounce this reckless, demagogic rhetoric. The government should not penalize law-abiding people, especially those who are American citizens, for holding their religious convictions. The White House is calling Trump's comments unrealistic, even grotesque.
What Mr. Trump said is deeply offensive, and as the Secretary of Homeland Security said, has consequences for our national security. But the real question for the Republican Party and for the Republican candidates is, are they going to be dragged into the dustbin of history along with Donald Trump?
Those who study presidential politics believe Republicans will not.
What you're actually seeing is that people are starting to rally around everybody but him. In other words, in some strange way, he is unifying the party against him.
And against a branch of the Republican Party that right now appears angry, anxious, and amplified. Kimberly Helkett, Al Jazeera, Washington.
For more on this, I'm joined by our guests in New York, Linda Sarsour, a racial justice and civil rights activist. Linda is also executive director of the Arab American Association of New York. In San Francisco, Matthew Del Carlo, Republican strategist and chairman of the California Young Republican Federation. And joining us via Skype from London, James Boyes, political historian specializing in U.S. politics and author of the upcoming book, Hillary Rising. A very warm welcome to all three of you. Linda Sarsour, as a Muslim representative, what is your response to what Donald Trump is doing at the moment?
I mean, Donald Trump is engaging in absolutely outrageous anti-Muslim rhetoric, trumping up fear amongst the American people. And the issue isn't really about Donald Trump. It's about the thousands of supporters that he has who believe that it's okay to ban Muslim immigration, to register Muslims in this country, and to basically paint a whole faith group as a suspect community.
I think that is what's been fascinating about this, is how many people he clearly represents, how many people support his policies. Why is that happening?
unfortunately, he's exposing a sentiment that has been living in these United States of America for centuries. I mean, he's giving the courage and the boldness to people who are predominantly white supremacists, bigots, people who have no problem with talking or vilifying a whole entire faith group. There are thousands of people who come to his rallies, people that line up outside hours before, and they cheer him on. And he said, we're going to ban Muslims. We don't want Muslims to come to our country. And they cheer him on. And this is really scary rhetoric. And unfortunately, this type of hate has never led to any progress.
Matthew Del Carlo, what's he up to?
I think Trump is resonating with people right now about concerns of where our country is going. I don't agree with Donald Trump. Our country is based on religious liberty. This is not constitutional, what he's proposing, but he's forcing an issue that is deeply concerned with a lot of Americans, where the foreign policy of the administration is not defeating ISIL, and people feel concerned. The president went and did an open Oval Office speech, and he talked about gun control. What does gun control have anything to do about terrorism? People in middle America and everywhere else are concerned about the direction of our country. And, you know, Trump is talking about that. I agree, again, I don't agree where he's talking on, but he's resonating on an issue.
So are you saying he's reflecting the electorate's views more honestly than, say, other party leaders at the moment?
There's a sign of freshness coming from Donald. Again, I don't agree with what he's saying, but he's talking straightforward. I mean, we've been, the Democratic Party has put out this PC culture, and everybody in DC, Republicans and Democrats, are not trusting elected officials right now in Washington because they don't feel like they're getting a straight talk. And Donald's offering straight talk, and it's resonating with people.
James Boyce, do you think Donald Trump could have possibly gone too far, or is he on the road to success?
Well, it's very difficult to try to suggest that Donald Trump has gone too far because, of course, time and again over the last 6 months or so, he has come out with a series of increasingly explicit statements. He's gone after women. He's gone after other elements of American society. We are now in the latest, most explicit incarnation of this. And every time the question is being asked, has Donald Trump gone too far? It's fascinating, I think, to see, though, the reaction of the mainstream Republican Party, who I think it's fair to say, and I imagine Chris, Matthew would agree with me, Donald Trump does not necessarily represent. They are now recognizing, I think, that Donald Trump is tarnishing potentially the mainstream GOP. So we've seen people from the Speaker on downwards denouncing Donald Trump. And I think one of the problems for the Republican Party is that whilst most mainstream members would recognize that Trump does not represent their views, from a foreign perspective, unfortunately, it plays into the perception of how the Republican Party really is, which I think it's fair to say is at odds with reality.
James, you touched on the fact that he makes comments that receive applause and he seems to be getting growing support. But let's talk about those polls then. He made those comments on Monday, the same day an opinion poll suggested that Trump had lost his lead in the Iowa caucuses for the first time. The poll, which was overshadowed in the media by Trump's remarks, put Texas Senator Ted Cruz at 24%, while Trump's rating had fallen to 19%. Worth noting, however, that in a different poll released on Tuesday, Trump had widened his lead in New Hampshire to 32%, up from 26% in September. Is that what it's all about, James?
Yeah, I think so. I've got to be honest. I have long been very doubtful that Donald Trump really is actively seeking the Republican Party nomination at all. I think what he's seeking is the Donald Trump Party nomination. And as a result, he's got several assets at his disposal. First of all, he's not a sitting elected member of any party. He has been a member of the Democratic Party in the past, for example. So he isn't beholden to any constituent at this point. He's also got a bottomless amount of money. He's already texting, Skyping over the last couple of days the idea that he is still holding out the possibility of running as an independent. And this, I think, is the real fear that must be at the heart of the Republican Party leadership, is that what you'll see is the Republican candidates rounding on Donald Trump. If he starts to fall further in the polls, they will feel emboldened to do so, at which point it's entirely feasible that Donald Trump can say, right, enough of this, I'm going to run on my own, I don't need you. And that, of course, will merely split the vote on the right and hand the White House to whoever emerges as the Democratic Party's nominee come 2016. We've seen this historically, of course. It happened with Ross Perot in 1992, and even when Theodore Roosevelt ran as an independent candidate and handed the election to Woodrow Wilson.
Matthew, is that what he's doing? Is he preparing himself to be an independent candidate, and could it work for him?
There's been talk about this, and I he's a pragmatic individual. I mean, I equate Donald Trump as the Kim Kardashian of the Republican Party. And I think what Bill was saying earlier about, you know, he's doing it for Donald Trump is correct. That being said, I know he's not a glutton for punishment. I think if he sees his poll numbers go down at a certain point, I think he will bow out. He made a really telling conversation on Meet the Press not too long ago. When asked, if your poll numbers go down, will you stick around? And he said, no, I'm not going to be a glutton for punishment. So it'll be interesting to see. That being said, yes, he's starting up a lot of controversy for the Republican base, but I'm proud to see a lot of Republican leaders coming out and speaking against him on this most recent position statement.
Linda, what do you think his strategy is, and what sort of impact could running on his own have on the Muslim community, have on race relations in the country?
I think Donald Trump, he represents the downfall of the American democracy. When a man can self-finance his campaign, Donald Trump doesn't need to raise money. He doesn't really have to do the hard work. He can really buy this election if he wanted to. What Donald Trump is doing is he's dividing our country. And yes, while members of the Republican Party have stood up against him, not as forcefully as I would have wanted them to, but what they've all agreed on, particularly the other presidential candidates in the Republican Party, that if Donald Trump becomes the nominee, that they will support him. So you can't in one side of your mouth say, well, we don't support his statements, but then the other presidential candidates are saying, we will support him if he is the nominee. He's creating an atmosphere of hate, which then unfortunately targets innocent people. And to be honest with you, I'm an American Muslim who 100% unequivocally stands against violent extremism. But there's also other types of violent extremism in our country that comes from white supremacist groups. We had 9 black parishioners shot down in a church. We have men shooting up Planned Parenthood offices, going into Sikh gurdwaras here in this country. So we want to talk about violent extremism, and we want to make sure that our country is addressing all the issues. Let's stand together as Americans against all forms of violent extremism.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that.
Violent extremism or terrorism.
I mean, it's interesting that it does come at a time where we've seen so many racist attacks, the policemen attacking black Americans. I mean, what do you think it says about what is going on in the country at the moment, this sort of growing polarization?
It's showing us historically where we've made mistakes, and one of the reasons why Donald Trump's rhetoric and his support the support that he's receiving is so scary is because we've had these moments before. The Chinese Exclusion Act, we've had Japanese internment camps, we've had slavery, we had Jim Crow, the new Jim Crow, mass incarceration, police brutality in this country. So this is not something that is new to the United States of America, and it is why we have to once and for all say never again in this country. When we talk about Muslim registration, this is something that Jewish Americans know very well, who have generations of families who understand what it means to be scapegoated. We can't have that in this country. So what we need to do as an American people is say, American Muslims are our sisters and brothers. We are all fellow Americans, and we need to stand up against all forms of violent extremism, whether it's coming from Muslims, whether it's coming from pro-lifers, whether it's coming from, you know, right-wing Christians, whites, whoever it is, any race, any religion. And that's the way that we're going to address this issue.
Let's talk about any race, any religion. I mean, many commentators online were quick to point out Trump is regularly photographed with Muslim celebrities, sports stars, and businessmen. Trump has met boxing legend Muhammad Ali several times, including at a charity event. Trump also has ties with wealthy Muslims in the Middle East. Many are business partners. Trump has signed lucrative deals with Dubai luxury developer Damac Properties and with Qatar Airways. And here he is with Sultan Ahmed bin Sulaiman of Dubai at a party in California. I mean, what sort of message is that, Matthew? He's stirring fear amongst Muslims. He's stirring fear against Muslims. And yet he has these Muslim friends in America and outside. I mean, what sort of message is that to his supporters?
You know, it's Donald Trump. I mean, like I said, he's the Kim Kardashian. He is a celebrity, and he's working the media, and he has the media around their finger, around his finger, excuse me. And this is his personality, and this is his celebrity status, where, you know, you have these very wealthy Muslim Americans and foreign nationals that are coming to see him and hanging out with him. Meanwhile, he's saying stuff that is totally inappropriate. That being said, there is a concern in America that we feel that Americans feel that the foreign policy of the administration is failed, and that recently this is the largest attack since 9/11, where we have had Muslim extremists, you know, do an attack and kill innocent Americans.
So he is touching on growing fear amongst many Americans.
Yeah, it's not the way that I would necessarily talk about it. I think it's wrong. But there is a fear that there's no leadership from D.C., and he's capitalizing on it. And quite frankly, this discussion should be about policy. I believe his policy position on this matter is wrong. But there is a policy position that needs to be taken. And the administration just said in the recent Oval Office, nothing's wrong. We're going to keep our same foreign policy. Well, guess what? It's not working.
James, he's not only stirring up anger in some quarters in the States. I mean, I know where you are in the UK, a petition came out early this morning. There's already 140,000 signatures, and I believe if a petition gets over 100,000 signatures, it needs to be debated in Parliament. And that petition is calling for Donald Trump to be banned. What do you think the wider fallout of this can possibly be?
Well, you're absolutely right. And one of the reasons that his remarks are resonating here in London is because he also said that there are parts of London that have become so radicalized that the police are terrified of going there. The mayor of London, Boris Johnson, has come out and forcefully denied this and actually invited Donald Trump to London to be able to show around where these areas are to disprove Donald Trump's point. One of the problems, as I said a little earlier on, is that what Donald Trump's remarks are doing is tarnishing the brand of the Republican Party. Whatever one thinks about left, right, Democrat, Republican issues, Donald Trump's remarks are being portrayed overseas as representing the mainstream of the Republican Party, which, you know, I'm sure Matthew will agree, they do not in any way represent most elected officials. And this is a major problem for the Republican Party. It's also important to recognize, just arcing back to a slightly earlier question you asked, Donald Trump has said only this week in the Washington Post that he will not quit this race and that he won't quit even if his polling numbers deteriorate. He's actually very much rescinded his original point, saying that he will only drop out if he runs out of money, and that's why other candidates drop out. Well, of course, he isn't going to run out of money anytime soon, which again raises a specter of self-financing. And whilst I think it's very easy to look at what Donald Trump's saying and take offense at it, I think there's another way of looking at this, which is I think it's going to actually garner more support from both mainstream Republicans and from the Democratic Party rounding against Donald Trump. And it is at least forcing Donald Trump's extreme positions out into the open, where they can be debated and discussed in a true democratic format, which, of course, is what American elected politics is meant to be all about. And of course, it will, I think, provide ammunition for the more mainstream Republicans to come together to counter. And so I think that it will only actually deteriorate and undermine Donald Trump's candidacy moving forward.
And you're a popular man listening to all those messages popping up onto your computer. Matthew, do you think that the Republican Party will be able to survive this? And how will the Democrats play this? Surely it can only benefit them.
You know, they are talking about it. But recently, with the Hillary and Bernie Sanders have recently come out condemning it and following the same as Republican leaders. They do say that this is dangerous demagoguery. But at the same time, they're not talking about the policy. They're not talking about why Americans are concerned about the direction of our country and our foreign policy issues. Kind of going back to the grander theme of, you know, is this hurting the Republican brand? I believe whoever becomes our front runner, and I don't believe it's going to be Trump in the long run, because in the end, the primary system benefits the moderate establishment candidate. One-third to maybe one-quarter of Republican voters are finally chiming in right now. That means two-thirds to three-quarters of the Republican base hasn't gotten involved yet. Most voters are not really aware about this issue. They hear and see certain things on TV, but the average voter hasn't seen it yet, believe it or not. Most of those Republican voters are going to be voting in the next 2 months in the Iowa caucuses in New Hampshire. Will probably make their decision within the last 72 hours and spend more time on this. So yes, there's some damage control that needs to happen, but the good news is that we have some really good Republican leaders out there that have already offered their own positions on foreign policy. They've condemned what Donald Trump has said, and I think in the long run, you know, people are going to forget what's going to go on with Donald Trump. And I do believe in the long run, Donald Trump will eventually bow out.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. But, you know, Linda, Donald Trump justifies his comments. He said because of security concerns in the country and that something must be done. I mean, I know you've received hate mail, abusive phone calls, being a Muslim. Has it got worse since September the 11th? And what impact do you think these remarks will have on Muslims in the community?
We're almost 15 years since 9/11, and the climate here in the United States is the most hostile we've ever seen, even compared to days after 9/11. We never saw mosque opposition in this country. We've never had white supremacist groups holding AK-47s in front of our mosques. We never had legislators passing anti-Sharia bills in almost two dozen states in the United States. We've never really heard this type of rhetoric. I mean, immediately after 9/11, we had Republican President George Bush stand up and say we're not at war with Islam. But what I will say is I do agree with Matthew, who's a Republican, and I am not a Republican. It is about failed foreign policy, flawed foreign policy, not just by the Democrats, but also by the Republicans. I mean, George W. Bush went into a war based on lies in Iraq. And we as a country have to take responsibility that we created the fertile ground for groups like ISIS and al-Qaeda to emerge. We never heard of these groups before 9/11. So Donald Trump needs to understand that right now he's creating a worse climate for American Muslims than after one of the most horrific and biggest terrorist attacks on U.S. soil in decades.
James, he's not alone, is he? I mean, I know that a lot of people have spoken out about this, but look at what's going on in the rest of the world, the far right growing in stature. So he's certainly got allies if he were ever to take the top seat.
Yeah, I mean, there's no doubt about it that when you have attacks like this within either the United States, as we've seen in California recently, or in Paris, we had an attack here on the subway just the last couple of days here in London as well. It does, engender a sense of fear, and in many cases, the far right are able to tap into that. However, you know, I think it's important to recognize, as I've been trying to make a point throughout this, that Donald Trump is on the far right of things with regard to this. And I would agree with Matthew that what you're seeing is the emergence of a series of more respectable Republican candidates coming forward and basically denouncing this. So whilst I think that, we can talk about Donald Trump's explicit statements, what he's not putting forward is anything in terms of a tangible policy that's actionable. And it's very right to take issue with what the president said in the Oval Office, I think, the other night, because many of us were waiting for a new policy development, and there simply wasn't anything there. So we are acting, I think, in a policy void at this point. Donald Trump is talking in headlines, but very few people are coming forward with tangible policies at this important stage in the American electoral cycle. And hopefully we'll see that moving forward into Iowa, New Hampshire, and then into the Carolinas.
Okay, we'll keep an eye on that for sure. James Boyce, thank you very much. Matthew Del Carlo and Linda Sarsour. Thank you for watching. As always, you can leave your comments on the program's page of our website, aljazeera.com, and you can post your views on facebook.com/AJInsideStory, or tweet us at AJInsideStory or at Jane Dutton. For me and the rest of the team, thank you very much for watching. Bye-bye.